Good evening, everyone. Today I'm going to be presenting a talk on the gastric ultrasound. So before starting, I would like to say that mostly this presentation will be consisting of images and videos and just a brief introduction and information in the periphery of why gastric ultrasound is important, a little bit about the update on the fasting guidelines as was recently updated in the IGA of July 2020. So this is just an introduction, and again, I am definitely a novice in this particular field. So I have tried my hand to capture certain images and videos, which I would like to share by the end of the presentation. So first and foremost question is why there is any necessity of gastric ultrasound. So for any anesthesia, be it regional or general, we require to know about the fasting details of the patient. So for that, we have to completely rely on the history which is given by the patient or the patient's caretaker. So, but again, as Dr. House once said, that everybody lies. So it may be on purpose or it may be by mistake, by miscommunication, that there can be misinformation which is given to us, which would prevent us from knowing the actual fasting details. Or it could be underlying conditions within the patient himself, which is not giving the correct information. The underlying condition is making the patient lie about what is the accurate fasting period. So why does it even matter to us? So we know clearly the Mendelsohn syndrome that has been highlighted since a long time in anesthesia practice. The pulmonary aspiration of gastric contents, which is a nightmare for any practicing anesthesiologist. So as we know that to prevent this aspiration, we need to know about the fasting period, and that is why it is most important. It is the single most common cause of death in airway management incidents. So what are the current fasting guidelines? Again, there will be a little bit update which will be thrown in the later slides. But right now, for clear fluids, there is a cutoff of 2 hours. For breast milk, 4 hours. For solid milks and unclear fluids, the cutoff is for 6 hours. So again, we'll see later that now with more fatty and fried foods, they have changed the guidelines for how much the fasting should be. But overall, the basic gastric secretion. So as we know that the gastric secretion is happening continuously, though the stomach can never be completely empty, but we accept up till 1.5 ml per kg of total body weight in an adult to be the baseline gastric volume. So again, we know that the severity of aspiration is proportional to the volume, nature, as well as acidity. So this volume as well as nature is going to play a very important part in our gastric ultrasound as well. So as we know that if there is an incident of pulmonary aspiration, it requires intensive care and ventilatory support and can lead to death of the patient as well. So as I talked about the update, which was given by the practice guidelines from the Indian Society of Anesthesiologists, which came out in July 2020. So here again, they have made a little bit of clarity here, where they have said that non-clear fluids, it takes about 2 to 4 hours to empty from the stomach. Whereas the light meals, about 4 to 6 hours, and heavy meals can take more than 6 hours to empty from the stomach. Now, later also, they have found that with the combination of solids and liquids, it can take up to 4 to 7 hours to empty. So if you say a cutoff of, say, 6 hours to be kept NBM, it does not cover, it does not ensure for every single diet that the patient is 100% NBM. So we have to keep that in mind. And later it was also found that for heavy meals, in fact, with fried and fatty contents involved, it has been recommended even that more than around 10 hours of fasting has been recommended. So it has also, this particular article in IAGA has also thrown light upon the gastric ultrasound. And they found that though most of the studies were done in patients, pregnant women, children, and in obese patients, that is the tricky age group, a tricky patient group, where this knowing about fasting as well as that their implication can have a serious impact. So they basically studied the gastric ultrasound in that particular patient group, and they found that it is a valuable tool in influencing the intubation and induction technique. For example, if you have ordered for a 6-hour fasting, but you have a diabetic patient or an obese patient or a pregnant patient, and with a gastric ultrasound, you can actually confirm whether the gastric emptying has actually happened and whether your patient actually is the gastric content is within the norm, within the acceptable range or not. So if you find suddenly that it is not, it is still in spite of the 6 hours, it is still above the recommended range, then you can plan a strategy for you. You can plan for a RSI induction or postponement if it is possible. So again, they have recommended that gastric ultrasonography can be used as a bedside tool, and in fact they have even compared it with scintigraphy, that is using the radioisotopes, which is used to measure the gastric volume, and they have found that it has got comparable results, and it is a useful bedside tool to aid, especially in patients where you don't have reliable history or those who are prone to delayed gastric emptying. So there were also some other studies that had taken place recently, in fact, in India itself, where they had studied around 100 patients they had studied to as a prospective observational correlation study. They had studied the gastric contents as well as volume. So here they found that even if fasting more than 6 to 10 hours, it does not guarantee an empty stomach, especially with comorbidities like diabetes, mellitus, obesity, chronic kidney and liver disease. They have found that in spite of adhering to that particular as long as 10 hours, they still found that there is unsafe gastric contents, and which makes these patients prone for pulmonary aspiration and its complications. So that is what had been found here. They also described their experience that initially they were finding it difficult to exactly understand the anatomy of the stomach. But with the practice, while they were able to understand the location of the antrum and its surrounding structures, they later found that it was easy to identify not only the content, but also the calculation of the volume, which later helped them a lot. And it was easy for them to perform later on in further cases. So just summing up, where is the indication for gastric ultrasound? As we said that it is not that in every single patient you need to apply gastric ultrasound to be sure that patient is NBM. But in certain cases where you are not sure about the NBM period, for example, non-adherence to fasting instruction, if there is emergency surgery, so there is no way to know, or you cannot wait for the whole period, for the 6 hours or 10 hours, whatever period is prescribed to get over. If there is misinformation, if the attendants with the patients do not know, if the patient himself is in altered sensorium or cognitive dysfunction, not in a position to give correct information, or there is language barrier where you are not sure about the NBM period, in short. And in patients where there is a delayed gastric emptying or chances of that, like in diabetes, mellitus, chronic kidney liver disease, in pregnancy, neuromuscular disorders, even in GERD, that can be tricky. So we have to understand before proceeding that before seeing it on the screen, you have to see it in your mind, and you must be sound with the applied anatomy, as in what is exactly that you are going to see and what are the structures surrounding it to help in correct identification each and every time. So just as an applied anatomy, so we are going very much briefly and to the point of what we are concerned with. So here we see there is this blue line, which is basically telling the plane in which the ultrasound waves will be passing when the transducer is kept in the sagittal plane, just below the sternum, just below the Zipf's sternum. So here we see when the ultrasound beams are passing through a cross section, here we see the left side of the liver, left lobe of the liver, which can be seen. Then it is cutting through this superior mesenteric artery. Here we can see, this is the stomach. So here we can see it is cutting through the antrum. So we can see that B and behind is the pancreas. So essentially your gastric antrum is sandwiched between the liver and the pancreas, and also superior mesenteric artery is also coming in its way. So you expect to see these structures on your screen if you put the probe in the correct position, that is in the midline sagittal plane just below the sternum. So we'll be seeing more images to get acquainted with it. So again, the question comes, when there is entire stomach, why do we concentrate only on the gastric antrum? So we find actually that with the antrum, it is more consistent and less variable. The body of the stomach, in fact, has more of the gaseous content, and they have found that antrum and fundus, they have more or less consistent volume, which can correlate with our risk of aspiration or total gastric volume. Fundus is more difficult to visualize through ultrasound, and antrum, more or less, they have found through years of practice and study that antrum is something which you see consistently most of the times. So that is why we prefer to scan the gastric antrum, as we can see here. Also, it is superficial, around 3 to 4 centimeters itself. And as we know that around the surrounding anatomy that we have to look for is the left lobe of liver, the pancreas underneath, the superior mesenteric artery. So this will help us in locating the gastric antrum correctly. Again, before proceeding, I would like to tell that there are two positions in which we scan for gastric ultrasound. One is the supine position, and the next is the right lateral decubitus position. So why the scanning in the supine position is helpful is that if you find that there is solid or thick fluid which is present in the supine position itself, you can be 100% sure that this patient is full stomach and the examination is complete. You can definitely have a conclusion that this patient is full stomach. But sometimes it has been found that in the supine position, you may not see as much volume accurately because the posterior wall is not seen properly. Once you turn the patient in right lateral decubitus position, you are able to, because it also shifts the gastric content towards the gastric outlet, so you are able to see the entire content gets collected in one place, and you are able to appreciate the whole of the entirety of whatever the gastric content is. Especially in pediatric patients, they have found that there is better sensitivity and specificity while they have scanned in the right lateral decubitus position. So later we'll see that even for the volume volume assessment or gastric volume calculation, the right lateral decubitus position is preferred. So that is why we prefer to do it in both positions. So once first you put it in supine and you are able to see that there is thick content, then your examination is over. If you are not able to see it in supine position, you have to make the patient in the right lateral decubitus position, scan again. Only if that is also negative, then we can say our examination is complete. And if there is less content or there is empty stomach, then patient is adequately NBM. So here again we see the position of the probe, how it is kept in the supine as well as the lateral position. So here we see that for adult patients, we prefer to use the curvilinear probe, which is frequency 2 to 5 megahertz. And for smaller children, we can still use linear high frequency probes. So here we see that the probe is kept in the epigastrium in a sagittal plane. So it is in the midline sagittal plane, just below the epigastrium, with our marker being cephalid. Here we see that in the right lateral decubitus position, the position of the probe remains pretty much the same. It is under the sternum and in the midline. So here in this position, is when you're trying to identify the gastric antrum, you can go from the left to the right subcostal margin while you're trying to identify. So you can just sweep the probe from under the left and the right subcostal. And as we discussed, we first start in the supine position and then we end the examination by making the position in the patient in the right lateral decubitus position. So what type of gastric content are we looking for here? So the image that you might see on the ultrasound, the antrum may be empty. There could be clear fluid. There could be solid. There could be mix of solid and liquid, which is generally what we can see post any meal, lunch or dinner. Or there is milk or suspension. So according to that, we'll see that appearance becomes a little bit different. So in an empty antrum, basically it is thinned out, it is collapsed. So we see a flat collapsed and a bullseye. Basically, because it is empty, you see that there is one hypoechoic structure which is in the midline. The hyperechoic marking that we see within the antrum is because of the muscularis propriae. So because of that, there is the hyperechoic. In the center, there is a hypoechoic because the stomach is empty. So that is the bullseye appearance. So we'll also see the gradation. So this is clearly grade zero. Then there is solid. So in solid, clearly you will see that now the antral shape is round and distended. The walls have become thinner. And here we see heterogeneous. That is, you will see basically whitish, to be in a very simple language. You will see that there is whitish along with air. There could be some black spots and the white spots. So that can be seen. When it is round and when there is clear fluid, it is round and distended with hypoechoic, mainly blackish appearing antrum. So with milk and suspensions, again, sometimes there's a curdled appearance, etc. is seen. So you'll see that there is hyperechoic or whitish spots which will be seen within the antrum. So this is, again, most of the presentation is taken from the gastricultrasound.org. They have a lot of helpful images which correlates with the anatomy. And it is it makes the anatomy quite fixed in our mind as to what we are actually looking at. And so always, again, whenever we are scanning, it's not just the target that we should be aiming at, but also the structures which are around it. Because the structures which are surrounding it, when they are correctly anatomically present, that gives us an idea that we are actually in the correct space. Because many times when you're scanning and you're not able to find exactly the book-like picture or the image that you had seen in presentations, it can become a frustrating appearance. It can become a frustrating experience. So at that time, it's always good to go by the anatomical structures. So these anatomical structures are pretty consistent. Your left lobe of liver will be very consistent. So always first try and visualize the left lobe of liver. So here we can see that where the left lobe of liver's edge is ending, at the end of that, there is the presence of the antrum. So here we see that there is a superior mesenteric artery which is going underneath it, and just adjacent to the left lobe of liver, we see there is a hypoechoic pouch which seems to have collapsed or collapsed or flattened. So that is our antrum which we are interested in. So here we can pretty much eyeball and see that it is collapsed and it is empty. There is no content in it. This is called as the bullseye or the target pattern. So next comes the solid early phase, that once the patient had food and it is still in the early phase. So what is the appearance that we see? So here we see clearly the size difference is very apparent. Here it is so small and flattened. So suddenly its volume seems to have increased so much. Here you can see that you're not able to appreciate anything of the posterior wall, because that has become completely blurred out because of the content. So there can be mixed echogenicity, or what they see with the solid content, there is a frosted glass pattern. As you can see that there is a whitish, definitely a whitish appearance, but it is kind of frosted or matte finish type of appearance that we see here. So that is indicative definitely of solid food. And solid late stage. So here again, you can see clearly that the antrum, as compared to the empty stage, it is definitely full. It is distended. It has got particulate matter. So there is white as well as black shadows that you see inside. So that is indication that there is fluid as well as the solids. So you can see that the gastrum is completely, gastric antrum is full. So when you are ingesting clear fluid without any solids, as we discussed earlier, that again, gastric antrum, as compared to the empty phase, it is distended, but it is full of the hypoechogenic shadow. So it appears black. So here we have to understand that gastric secretion is also something that could appear like this. So you might find that people, even with empty stomach, they might have this blackish shadow. So here we need to quantify actually by calculating the volume and seeing if this particular volume of in the gastric antrum is less than or more than 1.5 ml per kg of total body weight. So if it is more than that, then definitely this patient will come in a category of high risk for aspiration. So you need to calculate the volume in case where you see that the gastric antrum is distended, but it is black in color. So here we see fluid with air bubbles or a starry night appearance, which is again seen after the ingestion of clear fluids, effervescent drinks. Also, when there is mixing of the solids with the liquids, you see this kind of an appearance which can be seen. So then how do you interpret a gastric ultrasound? So as you said, first step, once you have identified the gastric antrum, is whether it is empty or distended. If it is empty, your examination is over, you're sure about the NBM. So next step is, once you discover that it is distended, what is the type of content, whether it is liquid or solid? As we know clearly that definitely semi-solid food solid content is more dangerous with the prospect of pulmonary aspiration. So we need to quantify which type of content it is. Next is volume assessment, because as we know that the risk of aspiration is also dependent on type of content, volume, as well as pH. Next step is risk assessment and decision. Once you have known the volume, once you know the type of content, you know the stomach is distended, you have to make a decision whether the surgery is emergent enough, which needs to be done now. If you're going to do it, how are you going to proceed with it? Whether there is going to be a rapid sequence induction or you want to postpone the case. So that, again, that decision has to be based on the assessment and personal preference of the anesthesiologist. So here also we can see if there is clear fluid, then again we have to calculate volume. If there is lesser volume, or which suggests that there is basal secretion of the gastric this thing only, if it is less than 1.5 ml per kg, it indicates that there is patient is not high risk for aspiration. So we can go ahead with the surgery with probably a regular plan. Next, if it is more than 1.5 ml per kg, even if it is only clear fluid, it definitely suggests that there is high risk. With solid, definitely there is high risk for pulmonary aspiration. Just a few special cases. Now with pregnant patients, what they first of all pose as a challenge is, how do you even scan in the supine position? Because the Ziffy sternum, the angle between your probe and the Ziffy sternum, it is very difficult to manipulate. You're not able to insinuate your probe properly. So that becomes a problem. Even if you're able to do that, you can see that here, because of the fetus inside, there is a shadow of the fetus, there is shadow because of the uterus and the placenta. So it becomes very confusing as to what you're looking at. So you can see clearly that from here, that is from the edge of the left lobe of liver, it has gotten pushed towards the right side. So somewhere here is the gastric antrum. So you have to be aware that there would be a variation in the anatomy in this particular patient. So what you can do to make it easier is, you can make the patient in the right lateral decubitus position, that manual displacement of the uterus can make it easier for you to identify. Again, this expertise can come only with more and more practice. And in pediatric patient, as we had discussed earlier, linear probe is required for these patients, the smaller patients. If the child is older with good weight, we can definitely use the curving linear probe. Here again, as we had discussed, that there can be a difference that in supine, you don't see that there is much of a, see, as we can see in this image. In supine, we see that more or less the gastric antrum by eyeballing appears to be quite collapsed only. But once you make the patient right lateral decubitus position, you find that as compared to supine position, is quite a lot distended. And it can become significant again, because we see here that the allowable fasting gastric volume is also quite less for the pediatric age group. It is between 1.1 to 1.2 ml per kg of total body weight. Plus, when they are still in the pediatric infant age group, there is definitely, like in 2 months of age group of the infant, there is a higher risk of pulmonary aspiration. So you have to be quite aware of that. So now once we have done, once you have, as we said, that you have localized the gastric antrum, you have eyeballed it, you're seeing the appearance of it, without going for the quantitative assessment, how can you proceed? So a qualitative three-point grading system is based on the appearance, whether it is flattened and it is empty in both. Again, both the positions are seen. So if it is still empty, it is flattened, and it is grade zero. So in grade one, we can see that the fluid is only seen in the antrum in the right lateral position, but in empty, it is empty in supine. So there is some fluid collection which you can only appreciate in right lateral. So that is grade one. Grade two is where you see in both the positions, fluid or food. So that is the grade three. So this was suggested by Pellas, who has done a lot of work in gastric ultrasound. So So then comes the quantitative assessment. So how do you go about the quantitative assessment is by the antral cross-sectional area. Now in the somocyte machine that we use with by using the calipers, by manually selecting the whole of the cross-sectional area, you can draw around the cross-sectional area as I'll be showing in further slides, and you will be able to know the cross-sectional area. So there are manual methods as well as automated software which are inbuilt within the system itself. So first you need to know about the CSA, then there are formulas which have been developed for both pediatric and adult age group in which you can put the value and according to the age you can get an idea about how much volume would be there. So again, this measurement, it is done in right lateral decubitus position because as we have seen that it is more sensitive for the amount of content that is present. So as we see that it is measured from serosa to serosa to get an accurate reading. So here we see that this is a formula which is more more commonly used for pediatric as well as the adult, and a lot of algorithms and easier gastric volume calculators have been used, so you don't have to even go through so much hassle in calculating the volume. So this is one such tool which has been bedside tool which was developed by Columbia Isha Hospital in Bangalore. So here you basically calculate. So as you can see, like they have given an example here, that here they have marked with the calipers. So that has already given you what is the area, cross-sectional area, which is seen as centimeters square. So you put that here, put the area here, put the age here, and automatically it will calculate the estimated volume for you. So it is basically like an easy app, or it can be present in your MS Excel sheet, and you can quickly calculate how much the gastric volume is there. So again, they have made these, this is again from the gastric ultrasound ORG, they have made point of care tools which would make the use of gastric ultrasound and its application very easy. So you know, immediately looking at the chart, how much is the volume, and according to the weight of the patient, how much is the patient at risk for pulmonary aspiration, and it can guide in the way that you would be following with your strategy for anesthesia. Again, as in every case, there are certain limitations with the gastric ultrasound. As we said that gastric antrum was considered for visualization because it can be easily seen in most patients, but there are always exceptions. In 2 to 3% patients, you may not be able to properly visualize the gastric antrum itself. In fact, in one of the volunteers that we were trying to scan, we were not able to identify it properly at all, which was a little bit of a frustrating experience. But looking back at it, there was definitely probably presence of colon because the bubble that we were seeing, it did not have appearance exactly like a gastric antrum. So probably it was colon. So if it is behind the pyloric antrum is behind the colon, you would not be able to properly see an image on your ultrasound. So you might require more maneuvers, more tilting, probably shifting the patient in the right lateral decubitus, or in some patients, in spite of all maneuvers, you may not be able to get a proper image at all. And of course, there are other problems where already gastric anatomy has been changed due to certain underlying conditions or due to surgeries, these issues can arise. So in gastric band or GERD, you might find the stomach is empty, but in spite of it, you might find that there have been cases where there is aspiration at the time of extubation that has also been found.
Last so, 5 minutes, 5 minutes for you. Last 5 minutes.
I'll just show you the attempt at the gastric ultrasound that we tried to do. So here we can see that this was done on our machine itself. So in empty position, we can see here that there is a target of the bullet appearance that we can see here. On left side, there is left lobe. Underneath, there is SMA. Next, this was after post-lunch frosted glass appearance, as you can see very clearly. In the same position, suddenly now the antrum has become distended and is full of white matter. Once we have take 200 to 300, you see that suddenly you start seeing light of a lot of hypoechoic matters, and the white matters, it starts appearing as if it's like a starry sky appearance. Here, again, using the calipers in the right lateral decubitus position, we have marked around the serosa from serosa to serosa of the gastric antrum. And here we have found that the area, so the antrum, which was so small, suddenly has become so distended. And we have found the area here. We can easily put that in the gastric volume calculator and know the volume. So in conclusion, I would like to say a new skill that you pick up will always help you at some point or the other. And definitely it is a knowledge which is worth having, and it can be our safety net in difficult scenarios. It can be considered a part of airway focus because the whole stress is on preventing pulmonary aspiration. So this can also be a part of airway focus in addition to the lung ultrasound and airway ultrasound. Thank you.
Yes, that was a really nice presentation, Pratiksha.
Thank you, sir.
Will you just close, stop sharing? I would like to share and show.
Yes.
So basically, for calculating the area, cross-sectional area, the position required is lateral decubitus position, right lateral decubitus position. And then only we are supposed to show. Okay. Let me so I hope you all can see this.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm just playing this. So that's the video on that gastricultrasound.org. So you can see nicely here the empty stomach. So in the parasagittal plane, when ultrasound probe is moved between liver and spleen, you tend to see, so this is empty stomach. So you see another empty stomach. So another video for empty stomach. So in the scanning here, you tend to appreciate this empty stomach. So what we are doing this is like sometimes patients for who are coming for emergency OT, this is an extension of our airway assessment, and we are assessing the lower airway for aspiration risk. This is part of airway assessment. So upper airway assessment and then aspiration risk assessment. Sometimes even the fasting is not completed, even if the surgery is over. So that time, we again at the time of extubation do scanning to assess the risk for aspiration. So basically aspiration risk is maximum at intubation and extubation. And if the fasting guidelines are not met at all these two points, we have to be very careful. So see, you can see nicely the clear fluid. So if seen in supine, just turn the patient into right lateral and do the cross-sectional area assessment. So basically any clear fluid more than 100 ml in adult patient is risk of aspiration, or presence of any solid content is always risk of aspiration. Another thing is many OPD patient, daycare patients do come to us, and previously when some patient has said that I have 6 hours of fasting, we used to believe that there is no risk of aspiration, but slowly we have realized that it is not so. There is a definite risk of aspiration even after 4 hours. So when we have checked in our patients at the end of 4 hours, we still could find solid content, and then we started thinking as whether the guidelines are absolutely all right and we should stick to it very sincerely. So this is another solid stage early content where you can appreciate in the pyloric endrum, you can see the gastric content. And in the late stages here, you can see solid late stages, something like this. It is mixture of solid plus some amount of air, and you see this type of appearance. Still late stage, you can still see further how the shape is changing and the structures are being seen. So this is another solid content. So if you identify solid content, then the risk of aspiration is too much. So I'm sure if we start using this as a tool, as a point of care tool for all our emergency cases and patients like who have comorbidities, where we are suspecting aspiration risk, it will be very much beneficial. So Pratiksha, one question to you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So are you practicing it for all your patients, more or less, or what is your suggestion? Like all actually, patients.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Up till now, this was actually the first time that I did the gastric ultrasound on the volunteers. Up till now, I think in one case we did use it when there was a similar case that the patient was posted for an elective surgery, BCS, and she had eaten around 3 hours prior. So we had done the scan and it had shown that there was solid food, and so we had refused the surgery. This had happened last week, I think. So that had happened quite recently where we had applied gastric ultrasound.
Yeah. So definitely it is very useful tool. And I think today we have a very short meeting of 40 minutes. So we are closing right away. I was thinking if we could cover
more. Is there a time limit, Amit?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, any question, Neeta? Any question, Neeta?
I had quite a few, actually.
Okay. Fine.